OBS has spun up. Restream is getting the data and sending it to YouTube. YouTube's starting up. Looks like Twitch is connected. Cool. Alright. Oh, and I see it on YouTube.
It's still... Oh, there we go.
Cool. There we go.
Welcome, everybody, to Doom Eternal. Yes, the game I've been waiting for. I am joined with a whole host of friends. First and foremost, Elena Yee is back with me to help me with the chat. Hi, Elena.
Watching them text.
And then Hayden Dingman, our illustrious games reporter, is here to talk about his review for PC World he put up today. Hi, Hayden.
I am here.
And then...
Okay, Adam?
Yes?
The YouTube? Let me actually refresh, Maybe I got it wrong. I thought for a second it still said full nerd stuff. No, never mind. I just need to refresh the window. We're good.
Okay. And then I'm also joined by Willis Lai, the video producer.
Hello.
Hello, everybody. It's a Friday. We're here to play some Doom. I launched it a little bit yesterday to make sure everything was running good on this machine. And boy, is it run really good on this machine.
What are you playing on, Adam?
So I had to go into the office and grab this HP Omen Obelisk with a overclock 9900K and a 2080 Ti. So
yeah, it it runs really. So I've got a 2080 Ti here, not a 9900K, but 2080 Ti, and I was getting, I want to say like 200 frames per second on Ultra, or really Ultra Nightmare or whatever the actual the name of it is.
Yeah, it is, let's see, I need to apply changes, I'm pretty much maxed out on everything, and it's looks like it's holding around 100, this is a beautiful game. I'm gonna start it up. I have yet to really play it, despite what you see on the screen right here. Are you sure you wanted to leave? Yeah. So we're gonna start fresh. Hayden, why don't you talk about your experience, your review of this game?
We like this game, or I like this game. We gave it a 4.5 out of 5, and I think the terminology we used was it rips, or alternatively, it kicks ass. I think both of those were in the review at some point. I think it's really fun. I don't know how much of it you've played, and I don't know how much Elena and Willis have played, but, can produce. It's war of Doom. I can say that, and that is fine with me.
Nice. No, I literally, I started it just to see a little bit of how I was running on this machine, but. Yeah, no, I haven't. This is my first time loading it up. And please, everyone in the stream, let us know if the game audio is too loud, or if my microphone is too loud, or whatnot. I will say I turned on the Ultra Nightmare statistics, and in the top right corner, it's reporting a lot of stuff. It's kind of nice.
Yeah, they. I left it mostly on just the frame rate counter for most of the game because the rest of it is very distracting. But
yeah, I'm gonna leave it up for the stream because I know the stream likes to see it.
Do you have two overlays in the left also?
Yeah, I was just thinking I should turn off GeForce Experience overlay. What is that? We got there. FPS counter off. There we go. Attempting to acquire the Hellbreast signal. Cool.
Nearly 60% of our planet has been consumed by the.
I mean, I gotta say, the music already is just giving me all the feels from from Doom 2016. It's the same composer, right?
It's the same crazy metal music, basically.
They feared the mark of the beast.
Is everyone saying it looks good on the stream so far?
So far, so good. Yeah, looking smooth. I can see your frame rate countdown.
I know I mentioned this to you, Hayden, earlier, but somebody in our stream yesterday, I think it was asking if you were going to review Doom 64. Or do you have plans to review Doom 64 for PC World?
Probably not. I mean, maybe if it was still as dead this week as it was a month ago when nothing was coming out, but. In case you haven't heard, there's some games coming out next week, next Monday maybe.
Oh, Animal Crossing just came out, so yes, you're good.
Yeah, that wasn't what I was referencing, but yeah, we got games coming out next Monday, so some games that people might be excited about. So I'm knee deep in some of those games, and actually, it's surprisingly busy right now between Doom this week. Game next week, Half-Life, and then Resident Evil is like the week after that, I think. Resident Evil 3 remake.
Oh, so yeah.
We finally have games coming out for like this 2 week stretch. It's actually perfectly timed if you're in quarantine because there is nothing much else happening in the world, but.
Except new games coming out.
Yeah, no, that's the thing. It's like it's the perfect time for new games to come out because there's actually stuff to do in my house. But
I will also mention, I don't think you know this, Hayden, unless you saw the description for the for YouTube, but I am indeed using a Steam controller.
Why are you doing that?
Well, I made a video. I will back this up because maybe other people don't know this. I made a video sometime last year when I got the SN30 Pro Plus in, and made a video of like, hey, is this the best controller for PC gaming? And a lot of people in the chat were like, hey, what the hell? You didn't even like include you didn't even talk about the Steam controller. And I was like, because I thought the Steam controller was dead. And yeah, a lot of people got angry about it. So when the Steam controller became, $5 or $2 or whatever the hell it was.
Yeah, something like that.
For the holidays, I was like, all right, cool. I will go ahead and pick one up. And when I got one in, I did an unboxing and I just said, I reached out to the community and said, hey, listen, can you please tell me why you like this? Wait, why can't I? What am I missing here? Oh, there we go. Okay. And yeah, a lot of people in the chat came out and they were super nice about it, actually, for once on YouTube chat, and kind of laid out some of the reasons why people still enjoy the Steam controller. And I was like, alright, cool, then you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to use this Steam controller that I just bought for a number of months, you know, and just like dedicate myself to using it and seeing what happens. So
I mean, I don't hate the Steam controller, but I don't know if I would want to play Doom with it. So
yeah, well, that was the thing though, is that you know a lot of people were laying out, hey, there's certain games that you should like pick it up first and play. And the two games that a lot of people mentioned that like benefits heavily from the Steam controller was Portal 2, obviously, because you know Valve was really pushing it back then, and then Doom 2016, because supposedly it was supposedly it has really good hooks into the Steam controller, and you can like really custom configure it. I will back up for a second and show. Oh no, I didn't launch it in. Oh crap! You know what I should do? Is there safe checkpoints in this, Hayden?
As in like places where it's saving?
Yeah.
Yeah, probably saved after you picked up that secret, and then maybe once you went upstairs. It's in the bottom right, so I can't tell because I think it's covered by the PC World logo.
Okay. I might risk it because I forgot to launch the game with Big Picture, so I can't get into the Steam controller configurations. Yeah, there, because it's such a new game, like there's not many custom profiles. But there was one guy who laid out a really good profile that was based off of Doom 2016. And so far, I'm still not a Steam controller aficionado, but
yeah. So like that's so I don't. I actually think we gave the Steam controller one of the better, I mean, me specifically, one of the better reviews when it came out, because I think that it's useful. I just don't play shooters with it. Like the games that I ended up playing the Steam controller with, or using Steam controller with, were like strategy games and stuff like that. Playing strategy games from like the couch. Because it's sort of like using a trackpad long distance.
Yeah, definitely.
I think I played like one or two shooters in our review with it, and then went, nah, I can see the mouse.
Well, and you're not a controller person that much anyway, right? Especially for shooters.
Not for shooters. For other stuff, I definitely use a controller quite a bit. In my opinion, the stuff that the Steam controller did good was the stuff that other controllers don't do very well. So like strategy games, and I'm trying to think of like what else. Puzzle games, anything like that like normally a controller is terrible at, I thought the Steam controller did well. And then stuff that a normal controller I already am used to. So shooters, though I don't really use one on a PC. But then also like third-person action games like Tomb Raider, stuff like that. I would rather just use a normal controller usually.
Well, yeah, that's the thing with I prefer using controllers pretty much on every game, even shooters. So if I wasn't using the Steam controller, I would be using the Xbox anyway. I know, don't worry. There's plenty of people
fired
in the chat that you're that feel the same way as well. But yeah, so like for me, using controller in this isn't like crazy. But I have, man, there was a huge learning curve to use the Steam controller in general.
Yeah, and that's I don't think it's a bad controller per se. I just already have a lot of muscle memory for normal controllers.
Oh yeah.
And so
I mean, yeah,
it was mainly
it's all
stuff,
my life.
As I said, it's like the like strategy games, the puzzle games, the stuff that like normal controllers are actually really bad at. That was the stuff that I ended up using the Steam controller more often with, because I didn't have that muscle memory, or at least if I did, it was like bad muscle memory. And so yeah, like stuff like Total War or whatever, you can kind of get away with using a Steam controller in a way that you would never use like a normal controller.
Yeah, but you know, so far so good. Oh yeah, I was gonna, let's see, I get this upgrade, let's see if it saves. Mod swap. Okay. Got it. Okay. Objective marker. Okay.
Okay, I do want to talk about like the spectacle of this game.
Yeah, please.
I think you kind of breezed past. There's like the Titan that's walking around outside right now.
Is there?
It was right before you got the mod.
Oh, I can go back.
Upgrade. There's like a giant Titan just like walking around out in that area. I think like the backdrops in this game are incredible.
Yeah, it is. I mean, this is a visual masterpiece. Like, I mean, but Doom 2016 was still, you know, pretty damn good too, but it didn't have like the huge open spaces like this.
So, from the chat, Dark Templar 102 wants to know, who is Adam speaking to? That is Hayden Dingman, our resident games writer.
Yeah,
he reviewed Doom Eternal for us, so You are listening to our in-house expert right now.
And it has a really good tattoos, you know. A lot of people know Hayden by his tattoos, so. but this soundtrack, oh man. Oh, so, wait, is... I'm not seeing that big thing you're saying is walking around, is that? I think this guy's sitting down. Am I getting too much flack in the comments for my Steam controller usage on a shooter?
No, actually, chat's been pretty quiet. I mean, there's only been the one question from XMeh on YouTube about asking how you feel about the Steam controller so far, but I feel like you answered that question already.
Also, can you, Elena, can you do a favor for me and check in Discord the live stream notifications and make sure that...
Oh, yeah, sure.
Because I think I figured out how to restream, get the notifications out there. Ooh. Willis, did you play Doom 2016?
No, I haven't.
What?
I think that's going to be one of the long backlog with a lot of games.
So oh.
That will be on the list. That's on the list.
Well, luckily, it's not too long. But man, it just for me, like, that was definitely my game of the year that year. But it just like this like power fantasy.
I think it would be hard to play. Like my only thing is, I think it would be hard to play Doom and Doom Eternal back to back. They're very similar games.
Oh yeah, definitely.
So I think that would be like you're right that like 2016 Doom is not super long, but I think it's like 9 hours. I think Eternal is like 13 to 14, and that's a lot of the same shooting.
Yeah, and actually, well, but don't worry, Willis doesn't like to pay full price for. For video games anyway, so. I bet you can get a pretty good deal on Doom 2016 right now, huh?
Yeah, probably.
another question I did have, though, is that, you know, somebody was asking about your Doom 64 review. We cleared that up, but did you actually ever play Doom 64? I actually didn't know what the hell it was until...
I didn't. I've heard about it in the past. And I knew that we were getting copies with the pre-order for Eternal, but I never actually played it back then.
Yeah, for some reason I thought it was like StarCraft 64, where it was just like a really crappy version of, you know, of a game.
Yeah, yeah, like
that you wouldn't
want to
play.
Yeah, same with like the SNES version of SimCity or whatever, right? Which came out at like the same time as SimCity 2000, and is not good.
I actually like that SNES one. It was fun.
Yeah, you like it because that was the one you played at the time.
Oh, exactly. Yeah. I mean, I never played any
I get
other
the
one.
Feeling Doom 64 might be the same way if you played it now, but I don't know because I haven't tried it yet.
Well, it was weird because I was watching Digital Foundry did a video actually on like all the different ports of Doom through the years. That was what I watched supposedly it's like it's almost like a sequel to Doom 1 and 2.
Yeah, it's like an actual standalone game, not a port, really.
Yeah, and I had no idea, so yeah, I was just like, oh wow, that's interesting.
So Adam, two
yes,
things for you.
Yes.
The live stream notification didn't work,
oh.
So I had to do a manual one. Huh. Just did that now.
Okay, thank you.
And then you have a question. Buzzman would like to know.
Hello, Buzzman.
If you have, if anyone here has experience with Xbox. Xbox Elite Controller Series 2, I believe both of you have.
Yeah.
And they also want to know your opinion on that versus the Steam Controller.
Hayden, go ahead.
I mean, I would take the Elite Controller. I have the Elite Controller sitting right next to me right now, actually. I don't think the Steam Controller is, as we were saying earlier, I don't think the Steam Controller is bad, but I definitely don't prefer it for pretty much anything.
Well, and also, I mean, it's hard to recommend, you know, even me, like, getting used to it and trying to understand what it's all about and why people love it, which I do understand to a certain point, the fact that it's dead. It's a dead platform, you know.
It'd be hard. I'm curious how hard it would be to get one at this point, because I imagine you have to go to eBay for that at this point, so...
Yeah. I mean, there's, you know, without like an active listing, I mean, even it's like, okay, so even if I fell in love with this, like, and if this broke, like, what the hell am I going to do? Like, go on eBay and, you know, hope that somebody has one? Like, no, I'm, you know, it's really hard to recommend just because it's, you know.
Yeah, I think it's like a fascinating platform. Novelty at this point. Sort of like I still own one of the Steam machines. It's kicking around.
Oh, yeah, that thing.
I own, like, the Alienware Steam machine, but I don't think there's much use in investing in it. And as I said, like, I have the Elite controller sitting next to specifically the second gen Elite sitting next to my computer right now. I don't have the Steam controller on my desk. I think it's in like a closet box somewhere. I'll say, so the Elite controller, the Series 2, that's the first controller that got me to convert to wireless on my PC.
Oh, nice.
Specifically like a wireless controller, because the previous Xbox controllers all used AA's still. And so even though I owned the controller dongle, but I never ended up using it because it was like, why should I buy? Like, why am I burning through batteries? I'm like 3 feet from my controller and I can just plug, or 3 feet from my desktop and I can just plug this controller in. But the Series 2 uses an actual rechargeable battery and it's like a really long one. It's like a 40-hour battery or whatever. And it comes with like a little charging perch. And so I just throw the controller on there whenever I'm done, and it sits and charges up, and then when I need it, it's already charged. It's sort of annoying to me that they still need the... You don't technically need the dongle, the wireless dongle.
Yeah.
But I don't have Bluetooth built in my desktop, so I might as well have the wireless dongle plugged in.
Yeah, I have that too.
I would need to have a USB dongle plugged in anyway. So yeah, I just leave that plugged in. Which makes it a little annoying because it ends up taking up two USB slots instead of just one.
Yeah, it doesn't need to be that wide, that dongle.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Well, they give you like that extension cable or whatever. So I actually have the wireless dongle plugged into the extension cable.
Oh, interesting.
It's mostly the fact that it needs to charge. So I have one thing plugged in so it can charge, and then one thing plugged in for the wireless dongle.
Oh, that's funny.
I don't know why they didn't just build, as far as I know. I actually am, like, as I'm saying this out loud, realize I haven't tested it, but I'm pretty sure the charging platform is just for charging, and I don't know why they didn't build a wireless receiver into the charging platform. Need the one. That seems like the way to do it, similar to like the Astro A50s.
That's a good point.
It's a charging platform and a receiver.
Well, and another thing, like just in practical day-to-day use, that kind of bugs me a little bit about the Elite Series 2, which is that it doesn't have an indicator on the actual charging thing, like where that is at. Like, I hate that for headphones, where like the charging case itself doesn't have any indication of how full it is.
Yeah.
So yeah, I'm like, wait, when does that need to be charged? And, yeah, I mean, I'm granted, also, not that often, but
I'm pretty annoyed that it pool of macros essentially that you can map onto the different rear paddles. They like super improved it on the Xbox.
So oh, yeah.
You can do all sorts of, like, you can map, like, taking a screenshot or trying to think of, like, the other ones. I've barely used it with my Xbox. But, like, they've added a bunch of functionality to those paddles, so you're not just duplicating, like, the face buttons onto the back.
Yeah.
And none of that works with a PC.
Yeah.
You can only map the actual face buttons or whatever onto the controller, which is dumb because, like, I'm running the Windows game bar and they have all sorts of stuff in the game bar for, like, you know, you can alt, I'm trying to think, it's like Windows alt print screen is take a screenshot through the game bar. I can, like, control Spotify through the game bar. There's, like, all this stuff, and you can't use any of that with the Elite controller on PC, which seems like a massive oversight. Like, why wouldn't you hook those two systems together?
Yeah, that is weird. Back to that one person's point, though. Also, you know, we're comparing a, you know, like a, I think full price, the Steam controller was what, at $60 or maybe 50?
Yeah, 50 or 60 at the time.
Where the Elite Series 2, which, I mean, definitely, if I didn't mention it, is my top pick. I mean, as far as controllers go, I love that thing. But, like, it's $180. That is a lot for a controller.
Yeah, it's, I've got one of those kicking around, and I've also got the Astro C40 kicking around, which is like $200 controller, so I am set on those controllers.
It's premium controller gaming, Hayden.
And then I have the Stadia controller kicking around, which is like $110 and doesn't do anything, so.
Well, actually, you know, damn it, I died. did everybody get that email for
Stadia?
For Stadia,
Division 2 was added to Stadia a year later.
Well, no, I got an email this morning saying Stadia, or the Founders Edition, whatever the hell the, you know, expensive version of it was, was $100. It was on sale for $100. Rather than 130.
Wow, what a deal.
Gotta go out and get that.
Yeah.
And play all three games on the service.
Yeah, and I was just like, oh man. I mean, part of me was like, you know, should I buy it and expense it just as a curiosity? And then I was just like, no, it's not even worth it.
Yeah, so I have the one that we got sitting here. And I have not touched Stadia since our review went up in November, I'm pretty sure.
I mean, why would you?
They keep sending me, like, increasingly sad emails about all the games that are being added. And that is, like, Steam World Quest. And then, yeah, The Division got added last week, I think. And I think I don't even know if the expansion got added. I just saw The Division 2 is on Stadia, which, okay, sure.
That's hilarious. Have you messed around
Adam,
with GeForce?
People are wondering.
Oh, go ahead.
I was gonna say people are wondering where you're sitting. I've seen a lot of speculation that you're sitting on a toilet.
I was gonna bring that up when you guys are done. Hayden beat me to it.
You know, part of me wants to leave it a mystery. You know, because maybe it's a mystery, but no, I in our new place, which you haven't been over to, Hayden. You know, I've live over in Alameda now, but yeah, the new place, I don't have an office. Oh, god damn it. And so yeah, we're not even fully, like, configured in our place yet, so I'm at our little kitchen table thing up against the corner in our living room, just so I could have my own little rat's nest of PCs and space here. So yeah.
Yeah, it definitely looks very suspicious. It looks like you have a wall on three sides of you, as if you're, like, playing in a closet.
I mean, that would be pretty funny, my gaming closet. But
I've been recording some VO in my apartment, and I've definitely been doing the old microphone in a closet for the past couple weeks.
Yeah,
so.
That's one of the things Lindsay and I are going to be doing over the weekend is trying to finish the setup in our place and try to have an angle here in the living room towards something that is more interesting than a white wall. For sure. So right now it's just like, this is the best space for me to kind of carve out my little workspace, because I'm not
when did you move? Because it must have been, like, right before the quarantine.
Yeah, no, it was February 1st is when we got our place. So we you know, moved over the course of a couple weeks, and, you know, we were out of the old place at the end of February. So yeah, and then all this stuff happened. So
that's a bad time.
Yeah, and I was pretty sad, because, like I said, you know, I don't really have a dedicated place for gaming anymore. But I also don't have a desk. So I've actually been testing just trying to play games on a laptop with an eGPU, that's been interesting. Luckily, I do have a nice rig right now to mess around with.
Speaking of Adam,
yes,
somebody in chat actually called you out on that.
Yeah, what's up?
They said, hey, wait a second. Weren't you playing on eGPU earlier because you said you had no room? How do you now have room for a desktop?
Well, I never said I didn't have room. like, I mean, if you have 3 feet of space, you literally could have room. But it's not the way we wanted to use the room that we do have. Because, you know, as Elena knows, like, you know, we're kind of me and my wife are kind of minimalist people. And we don't like to have clutter. We don't like to have a ton of stuff around. So, yeah, I mean, I could fit 20 desks if I wanted to, but, like, I would prefer not to, so. yeah, so, like, we're going to have to rearrange our space a little bit anyway. What? Damn it.
Okay, I'm going to give you some advice, Adam.
Yeah, what's up?
So I don't think you're fully taking advantage of the fact that every enemy in Eternal has a weak spot. They're kind of showing it to you on the loading screens here, but I know we're talking, so who knows.
So
like those spider dudes, you want to shoot their tail guns off, and you can do that with just one shot of the zoomed in assault rifle, and then the Caco demons, who you keep just like dumping ammo into, if you shoot a grenade into their mouth, they swallow it and immediately turn staggered. Dump a grenade into their mouth and then chop them in half. Or actually, I think the Caco Demon one is the funniest one. You rip their eye out, which is a lot of fun.
Yeah, I'm still getting used to this setup. Okay, thank you.
It's vital later on in the game, because like every special enemy has a weak point. And they had some of that in 2016. It was like the pinkies, which are like the tiny dinosaur looking things. They're armored in the front and you have to shoot their tails off. And that was in the Doom 2016. But this one, they've like pretty much every single special enemy has some sort of weak point. So like, I think later on, the Marauder is like the most annoying enemy in this game. He's got a shield, and he only lets down his shield when he swings his axe at you. So they like give you a cue that he's about to swing when his eyes blink green, and that's the only time you can damage him. I think it's the Incubus or whatever, the like big two arm heavy armor guys. You can shoot their arms off. And the Revenant, which is like the skeleton with the missile launchers on its back, you can shoot the missile launchers off. So it's helpful because they all do less damage, and also they take a lot of damage when you shoot those weak points.
Okay. Yeah, I just shot off the tail of that the brain thing.
Yeah, that makes them super, super easy compared to like when they have the crazy assault rifle on their back. Because once you shoot their tail off, it's just like all they have is like a grenade launcher or something that doesn't hit very often.
I will say, just like Doom 2016, I always have an adjustment period for pulling the left trigger to look down sights.
Yeah.
Oh my god.
Mine was actually reloading, because you can't reload in this game.
Oh yeah.
And so it like makes your flamethrower or whatever work. And so I kept hitting R to reload, and then my guy would just shoot flames into the air, not any enemy, which is completely useless.
Yeah, I remember the reload thing. But yeah, the left trigger thing. Oh, that, I don't know why, but that really gets me.
Yeah, I can't remember what they used R for in Doom 2016. Because, you weren't reloading, but I think you still had... you didn't have the flame belch thing in 2016, so I don't know. Maybe it was the chainsaw or something.
Oh, yeah, you're right. That's the chainsaw right now is what is on X.
But yeah, those weak points become like essential, because by the end they basically dump like every special enemy in the game at you at once, and sometimes like multiple. So you'll have like six of those spider guys fighting you at the same time, which gets really wild if you don't shoot all their tails off.
So real quick, without spoilers, it seems like there's a lot less story, at least in these opening moments.
I would say there's more story. It's just that you're not reading the codex entries. There's a lot of story in the codexes, which I think is the most boring way to tell a story.
Oh, crap.
But a lot of it also pays off really well. So it's kind of like a, I don't know. I'm real torn about how they told the story in this, because I think it probably has fewer big story reveals in the actual game itself. A lot of it is hidden in those lore entries.
Oh, interesting.
Also, if you read all those lore entries, the story is really wild. So, yeah, they definitely, like, lean into some of the stuff from the 2016 game of, like, the Doom Slayer being a god, essentially.
Oh, wow. But overall, what'd you say, 4.5?
Yeah, I mean, we should clarify that we are on a 5-point scale so that people are not.
Yeah, why so low?
Yes, a 4.5 out of 5.
4.5 out of 10.
Yeah, before everybody leaps down my throat. Yeah, 9 out of 10. I think this game is great. We'll see. It's the, you know, it's a console release year in theory, assuming that.
We'll see.
Yeah, assuming that the
factory. We'll see.
Get that put together at some point, but yeah, because yeah, we'll see. But I would say this is definitely a game of the year contender, given how completely empty the spring has been. Like, this is the first. It's like this and Kentucky Route Zero are the first games that we've really reviewed this year. I'm pretty sure.
And
Ori, and that was like a much smaller review.
I actually, you know, I haven't seen you for a bit, Hayden. What's your take on these new consoles? We've talked about it a bunch on Full Nerd, but
they seem super powerful.
You ready to give up your gaming PC?
No, but I am, like, I've had a bunch of friends who are looking at upgrading, and I've tried to tell them all, like, hey, maybe don't upgrade this year.
Upgrade their PC or their console?
Yeah, upgrade their PC. Because this seems like probably the worst year to upgrade, because there's a lot of stuff that we don't know about those new consoles still.
Oh, don't tell Gordon this. What are you talking about?
I'm pretty worried about especially the SSD requirements on those new consoles. I'm pretty worried about what that's going to do for PC ports and how easy it'll be to actually execute a PC port starting next year. Or I guess starting technically late this year, because there's a lot of people, myself included, who are still running the vast majority of games on a 7200 RPM hard drive.
Really? Wow. Oh yeah, because you need a ton of space.
Yeah, I've got an SSD. I've got two of them. But like, when these games are 100, I mean, Doom is like 70 gig or something. I can't remember.
It's a lot of space.
And like, my Call of Duty install at this point is up to like 160 gig or something.
Yeah.
So I've got 2 terabytes of SSD space, but like, SSD space is not cheap. I've for a long time had 2 terabytes of SSD space and then like 12 terabytes of hard drive space. Yeah, there's a lot of stuff that I still am running off of the 7200 RPM hard drives, and I just don't think that's going to be possible starting next year. I'm curious how they're going to handle. Like, I don't want my load times to suddenly be like 8 times as long as a console.
Interesting.
So yeah, I think there's a lot of stuff about that aspect in particular that's unknown. The rest of it, like, whatever, man. Like, I have a 2080 Ti. The Xbox Series X looks like it's going to be about a 2080, so I'm not super worried about all of a sudden not being able to run these games or anything. Just like last time, just like 2013, I will already apparently have a better graphics card on day one of these new consoles. But like, that's because that's a $1,400 graphics card. If you're spending $500 on a console, you're not going to get... similar to like the Xbox One X, it doesn't look like you're going to be able to get a PC that is better than those consoles on day one for the same price. So I think it's impressive, and I think it's cool. I'm excited to see what happens to the PC space. I'm not probably going to switch over to consoles. And in fact, like, I'm definitely not going to buy one of those Xboxes because I just run all Microsoft stuff on a PC now anyway.
Yep.
But PS5, maybe. But I would probably need two or three good reasons to buy one of those. Even so, like, it seems like everything that I've seen specs-wise seems very impressive. And especially that SSD stuff just seems like it could be a real game changer finally. We've had like no real progress on that front on the PC in so long at this point. It's just been like, things will run better on an SSD, but like we can't really guarantee everybody will have one, so we're not going to build around that. And finally it seems like maybe we might actually see some games that take advantage of people having SSDs. I'm just really curious whether that ends up being are we going to get to a point next year where, like, I'm trying to think of a game coming in 2021, but, you know, Godfall or whatever, that Gearbox game, is that going to be like the minimum spec comes out and it's like you have to have an SSD in the minimum spec? That could be super interesting.
That's a good question. I don't think we've really talked about that
before.
Yeah. Do you think that would really happen?
I think it's possible. Like, if they design those games around everybody having instantaneous loading time on a console, I think it's definitely possible that we get to a point where, like, you need an SSD, and there's a chance that it's not even, hey, you need an SSD. There's a chance that it's, hey, you need an M.2 to take advantage of the speed increase over a SATA drive.
Oh crap. Oh man. Oh man. This whew, I am dying a lot here. This seems a little harder than last time.
while you deal with that, I have a question for you, Hayden, from the chat.
Yep.
Ashkan Fahiri, sorry, wants to know, what games have you given a 5 out of 5 to, a perfect score?
Oh, good question.
Witcher 3.
Celeste.
Yeah, it's like Witcher 3, Celeste, and we probably would have given one to Edith Finch, but we didn't review it. I'm trying to think, like, big budget, what we've given a perfect score to in the past couple of years. It hasn't really been much. I think Witcher 3 might be one of the only big budget mainstream games that we gave a 5 out of 5 to. We give a lot more 4.5 out of 5s. Doom definitely got that. I think a couple of games in 2019 got it. I'm actually like pulling up our review list now to look through. It looks like Red Dead got a 9 from us. Disco Elysium might have gotten a perfect score from us last year, but I don't think we ended up writing a full review for it, because it ended up, by the time I was done with it, we were like a month out from Game of the Year, and we just gave it Game of the Year prize. Tetris Effect got a 9 last year. Outer Wilds got a 9, I'm pretty sure. We gave out like a surprising number of 9 this year. Kiwami 2, the Yakuza remaster, got a 9.
Ooh, I love that one.
Heaven's Vault, the Inkle game, got a 9. Devil May Cry 5 got a 9. But yeah, 10s are super rare for us. I think I've only given out like a handful in the 7 years I've been reviewing games for us. And I'm not really like a purist about that stuff. It's just kind of, it's something that has to be really impressive to me to give it a perfect score.
Right. It's not easy to earn.
Yeah, we definitely have not given out, as I said, I think I've given out like 5 of them in my entire time. So. And yeah, Witcher 3 is the one that immediately just comes to mind, because that's the level of game that we would usually give a perfect score to. And to be honest, I think that this year has a chance to see quite a few perfect scores, as long as all those games actually come out. Yeah, like looking through the backlog, Rocket League got a perfect score from us.
Oh wow, nice.
And Soma, the last Frictional game, that got a perfect score from us also. and Kerbal Space Program. That looks to be the other one that I've
Kerbal, wow. Okay.
Kerbal.
Nice.
Yeah, I think at the time, because this was like 2015 or whatever, it was right when Kerbal exited early access. And I think at the time I basically said Kerbal was like the ideal of what PC gaming should be, which is like, hey, we have this really weird idea and we dove super deep into it to make this like wild simulator that ended up being so good that like NASA was like using it for, you know, like people were like training on actual rocket science through Kerbal. That sort of stuff I think is like, I feel like R10s end up being more philosophical questions of like where I would like gaming to go and less about like a statement on the quality of a game.
Interesting. Yeah, I like that. It's a good way to approach it.
All right, Adam, yes. Jumping to another question that's a little more specific to Doom Eternal here. Brian Finkel wants to know, do the shards from enemies killed automatically come to you, or do you have to run over to them?
I think there's a little bit of a magnet.
Yeah, there's a slight magnet, but I think you still have to, like, they reward you being in close, basically.
Didn't. Oh, this music.
Also, I'm going to jump in. I see Elvis Knot or whatever asked me about keyboards.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, we get a lot of people asking, like, what does Hayden think about this keyboard or that keyboard?
Yeah, so I'm still using... we kind of have slowed down reviews because I'm at my house. I'm still using the latest K95 Platinum. I think it's like the Platinum XT or whatever, which we reviewed in January, I want to say. That keyboard is super nice.
With reds or what kind of switches?
No, we got blues on this.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it's one of the few Corsair keyboards that I've actually, they sent me blues for. Because usually they send me the...
Speeds?
Speeds, yep. The silvers. Before that I was using the Logitech, oh man, I'm going to screw up the name, but it's like the Logitech Pro keyboard or whatever, which is a, Logitech G Pro X, which was a hot swap board. You can yank the switches out and replace them with other switches. So I had a lot of fun with that because we were... I think they gave me a blue default, and I ripped all the gaming keys out and replaced them with reds.
Nice.
And it's like a very easy process. They basically just made a very polished hot swap board, which is something enthusiasts were doing for like years and years. But usually it means like breaking out a soldering iron and doing it yourself. So it was cool. They like basically just send you a box full of replacement switches. So I've got in the closet like a box of reds and a box of browns. It was cool. It was a fun little project. I don't think there's anything like on the... They were asking specifically if there's anything on the horizon, but that's not really how keyboard stuff tends to work. It's usually like a week before launch we get notified that there's a keyboard coming out, and then they send us over a review unit. Nothing in the future, but those were the two standouts from the past couple months as far as interesting keyboards.
I wanted to ask you, because once again, I haven't seen you in a while, what do you think about E3 canceling? You happy? You sad?
I mean, I was cracking jokes before we all went into quarantine about how they were going to cancel it and blame it on the quarantine anyway. I'm not super surprised. I'll be sad. Like, you and I have had some good times down at E3.
Yeah.
And I've had some good times by myself at E3. So, in theory, I'm sad about it, because, I don't know, there's something about going to E3. Like, that was... you've gone to E3, and maybe you don't feel this way, but, like, that was something that I used to read about when I was a kid.
Yeah.
In, like, EGM, and be like, oh, I want to go to E3 one day.
Hell yeah.
So it was real exciting the first time I went to E3 back in, like, 2013 or whatever. On the other hand, like, the E3 last year was one of the saddest trade shows I think I've ever been to. So,
yeah.
That was like you weren't with me last year, were you?
No, last year I missed.
Yeah, so last year was like I think it was G Fuel or whatever, one of the like energy drink companies was just like handing out G Fuel on the show floor. Bang was there with like a giant booth hanging out energy drinks, and like half the show floor was empty, which like none of that affects us. Like I think something that people don't realize for E3 usually is like journalists actually are not really on the show floor ever. We're up in like there's a bunch of meeting rooms in the convention center, and so most of the actual journalism business happens in those meeting rooms, which is not open to the public. So like our E3 experience never really changed, but every time I would go down to the show floor just to like see what it was like, it got worse and worse every year. And so, yeah, I don't know if that was how it was going to be this year, and they were talking about all the like activations that they were going to do, all the like bad marketing stuff they had planned. I've got like zero desire to go see that.
Well, yeah, you missed out on some hot activation action.
Yeah, I missed out on like I don't know, like Seal selling autographs or something. Who knows?
What, really?
No.
That would be hilarious.
I'm just trying to think of like which like D-tier celebrity they could get that people would be like, oh yeah.
Oh no, you just pissed off so many Seal fans, Hayden. You better watch out. They're gonna be coming for you.
I bet, like I would. I bet Seal would say yes. Is what I'm saying. Like, yeah, all right, sure.
Oh, that's funny. Well, yeah, it.
Most of the shows that we care about are still gonna happen. Like PC Gamer's already put out a statement saying, like, yeah, we're still gonna probably do the PC Gaming Show. Microsoft's gonna do their thing online. And as far as like the getting hands-on time with demos and stuff is concerned, like we probably, I would assume, are going to end up going somewhere and doing those demos. It's just a matter of like when that's going to happen and how, especially with like the quarantine happening, like how those demos are going to be served to us, I think is the question. Like we definitely, I mean, we had GDC up for this week, right? Yeah, it's Friday, so yep. This would have been the last day of GDC today. All of those got canceled, but then like some of that stuff ended up getting passed to us digitally, and some of it was so close to release. Like I think I'm allowed to say this. I should check something real quick. Give me a second.
Yeah, no rush.
I don't know if I told you about this. I've never been to E3 before, so you know, I think it was now that a lot of developers are doing their own, you know, conferences and whatnot. Not sure, you know, if I should say, you know, like, you know, I'm not gonna miss out as much for like E3 and the coming. I mean, like, you know, this year was canceled, but like, you know, future. Please, I don't think I'm gonna miss out much, right?
Yeah, I'm curious whether we'll even get a comeback. Like, I think we will maybe get one next year, but I wouldn't bet on it, to be honest.
Well, also, ESA needs that money, right? I mean,
yeah, but like that's
the revenue generator.
The question is whether the people will, like, not the crowds, but like the actual developers will show up.
True,
right?
If they're still asking, you know. Like Microsoft seems all in, but if they're asking like Activision or whatever to shell out a couple $1 million for booth space, there's a good chance that Activision just goes, "Nah, we're good." Doesn't bother. I was gonna say before the game that I was thinking of was the Control expansion, which is that's coming out next Thursday or whatever, or maybe the Monday. I don't remember. Yeah, next Thursday. That's coming out next Thursday, so we were supposed to have a demo of that. Yesterday, it went in the happier times when GDC was still happening. But then, like, that's so close to release that, like, they just sent over review code. So we'll just do it that way. We won't end up doing a preview, which, like, fine, whatever. So yeah, it'll be interesting on our end, but I don't really think much will actually change from a journalism perspective per se, because we will just end up going to events that aren't called E3. It's mainly just the spectacle of it will be a lot smaller.
And the chance to meet Seal, I guess.
We're
gonna miss out on
that. Seal.
Or actually,
no more chance to like there... walk past Mike Tyson in the hallway or whatever.
Yeah, there's that time we saw Kanye in the hallway.
Really?
Yeah, that was when they revealed Cyberpunk. So I guess what, 2 years ago now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh. there was that year that they built the giant Doritos arcade cabinet outside.
Oh yeah. Hey, that was a good video.
No more Doritos arcade cabinet with a VIP Doritos party with FIFA performing. We're really missing out on the
the
hot stuff.
The stuff that really mattered.
Going to that, I remember like going to that just so I could get a wristband that said Doritos on it, and then taking like 6 bags of nacho cheese Doritos and
having a heart attack.
Yep. I mean, it's E3, so that's like built in.
Yeah, true. A little sleep and lots of alcohol,
like,
that does it to
three,
you.
3 energy drinks in.
Oh my goodness.
I just spawned a fight in the comment or in the chat about whether an Xbox actually is useful if you have a gaming PC these days. So,
I would say no, right?
I mean, that's what I would say, but people are really, really,
really
fighting about it.
What's
I mean, so I will say like what I said earlier applies, which is I think the Xbox One X when it launched and the Xbox Series X presumably next year will be better than any comparably priced PC at the time. Like I think the Series X will be more powerful than whatever the equivalent PC build is.
Yeah.
Like almost certainly.
But you don't get to run Windows on it. How are you going to do your taxes on it?
I mean, that's the thing is like, you'd use a PC for different things, so I think that is the question.
I'd jump in real quick and just say that I think Natalie Gray has the use case that most people would for having both, which is if you have the spare cash, you could have both, and then you can go easily from your PC to the living room if you're playing a Play Anywhere title.
Yeah, I just don't play anything on my TV, so that's the difference, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, I resent having to play PlayStation games on my TV and not just at my monitor, so... yeah, that's I think, the difference. I don't really, like, begrudge people that play stuff in a living room. That's just living in a tiny San Francisco apartment, not a thing that applies to me, so...
I do want to know why the Doomslayer can't get through these big holes in the gate. I know you're going to be a little delayed, but I think that's funny that you can't get through those.
Yeah, there's some stuff like that in I think VR games are even worse about that because you're like, I could easily walk through this. this thing.
I really like this this Gregorian chant going on in the
Yeah, there's some really in inspired music choices in that game. Also, I don't know if you've gotten there yet. Have you gone back to like the hub space station yet?
I think well, I'm in some sort of thing that says I can start fast traveling now.
No, so that's like you're still in the level. So you can fast travel at the end of every level to go pick up secrets you missed, which is cool. After a certain point, you end up going to your like hub area, which is a space station, and all of the albums that you collect, you can play the music from while you're in that space station, and they have a bunch of tracks from like old Doom, tracks from the old Quake games. I think they have one Commander Keen track, and so that's really fun because you can run around just playing like original Doom music in your space station.
This stops nothing. That's cool. The sacrament of this I dig world. It.
to the great Khan Maker will be made, and the energy.
There's this priest guy that's talking to me. Man, that headpiece looks so familiar. Like taking some for some movie. So I guess the Doom guy still doesn't talk, right?
They actually have an explanation for that in the codex at one point.
Okay.
This is humanity's chance to repent, to give service to us.
Is the stream quality holding up? I could change something real quick.
It looks good to me, but I don't know if you've already.
Yeah, I started it like a minute ago. Okay,
looks good on my end.
I was just testing something out for later. Okay, so Hell on Earth, I did it. Oh man, everyone got to see me suck real bad at that. There was one more toy. Cheat code. I like how the cheat code has a little floppy disk icon. That's pretty funny.
Yeah, it's actually a floppy disk. When you pick them up in the world,
oh really? Like
a floppy disk with a label on them.
Oh, that's funny.
Yeah, it's like that, and then the records are actually, like the music tracks are actually records, which is also a fun one.
Call back to a previous era. The thing does, yeah, the performance, man, is pretty damn smooth. I mean, obviously everything's maxed out and I've got expensive hardware, but it feels pretty damn good.
Yeah, I really like this game, and I'm amazed that they got it to look so good and run this well at the same time.
Oh, okay, now I'm back. Now I'm on some sort of space station, I think. Huh. I'm hovering above some sort of planet. I guess I don't know if it's Earth, but
it's not. It's Argent or whatever. They have a name for it. It's an in-universe name. It's basically Earth.
Oh, I just got flame belch. So yeah, I guess all those little like pieces, those burning pieces of paper I have. Those are the codex that I'm not reading.
Yeah, those are the codex, burning pieces of paper. I think there are a few too many of them, but they're well written. It's just not really what I wanted. There's like one level in particular that is like just one long hallway where you end up picking up a bunch of codex entries. It's like 13 of them in one level or something. Wow. And there's barely any shooting in between, and that was the one that I was like, this is the worst way to have told this part of the story.
Hmm. Interesting. Sentinel Crystal tutorial. Interesting. Oh, there's the loot magnet. As long as you're at max health, as long as you're at max armor. I want to put out there in the chat, are people in the chat, are they actually playing it as well? Let me know what your experiences are so far.
The portal is activated and ready when you are.
Yeah, I like this. You might be past it by the time that this actually gets routed out, but I like the upgrade system with the crystals.
Uh huh.
Where you have to, like, you are choosing two perks on opposite sides of, like, a much larger bespoke perk thing.
Yeah, I just got done with that.
It's neat. It's like a. It like encourages you to actually upgrade everything and not just like stick to, okay, I'm just gonna upgrade health every time. Because yeah, some of those perks are super super useful. I think there's one that applies to the grenades, maybe, that's like every time you fire a grenade and it kills somebody, they spawn more grenades.
That's cool.
Really wild chains happen later on in the game.
Oh wow. Yeah, these are some huge like landscapes. So I think most people aren't, or most reviewers aren't fans of the platforming, right?
I just find it kind of pointless. I think it all moves really well. I just don't really understand the reasoning behind it. I actually think that it's neat for the secrets. Like, there are a couple of secrets that are fun to puzzle out how you're supposed to grab them. But there's also a lot of it that just feels like kind of shoehorned in, and it makes some of the levels seem like much more video gamey. There's like one screenshot we used in our review that's like straight up a Mario level with like spinning like those spinning fireball poles. Which like just, I don't know, it like comes off as like a little too cartoony even for Doom for me.
Also, these platforming things where you like jump towards a pole, and then get like use your gymnastic skills to vault even further. That feels a little weird to me.
Yeah, it just kind of, I don't know. It didn't really do it for me, or like it didn't really do anything for me, I should say. I just don't really understand like the usefulness of it.
I guess it makes for bigger environments, but
yeah, I mean that's the thing, is like it doesn't really hurt it. Like, I've heard of some people getting really stuck on some of them. I think I got stuck on like one, and it turned out why I was stuck was just I didn't actually notice there was a platform that I hadn't jumped to yet. So like I didn't really find it difficult. It was mostly just like, okay, I guess we're just gonna slow down and spin off some poles for the next 2 minutes.
Interesting.
I think they could have easily done like the exact same thing, but just instead of making the I don't want them to get rid of the mobility, because it's like it's fun to do the double jump and the dashing and all that. I just don't know if they needed like platforming puzzles to justify that.
Mm-hmm.
That's the part that I find kind of useless.
You know something?
Jump in real quick, actually. So just a random catching up here from the chat. Adam, to answer your question, Shimami says that they are playing and ahead of you.
Oh, nice.
I know Ziv, I think, actually left the stream because he wanted to go play. He got ahead of him. And then randomly, whenever you guys have a chance to answer this question, Cannon Wright wants to know, now that TP is out of stock, I wonder if bidet sales are through the roof.
I hope so.
We actually have somebody who's a plumber in our Discord, on our Discord server.
Nice.
And he was saying that his business has been very good the last week or so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, all the days were sold out on Amazon like last week, so I imagine they're doing pretty well. As far as I know, toilet paper might be back in stock in San Francisco finally. But
oh, is it?
That's I've heard since Monday.
Huh.
Some places have finally gotten it back in stock, because now they're putting like less, like they got all their panic buying out of the way on Monday. But
yeah.
I haven't been to a store since Monday, so I also don't really know.
We'll have to see. I mean, honestly, it would be a dream for us to get like full Japan style toilets.
Yeah,
everywhere.
It would be amazing.
I had a fierce debate with a friend of mine, though. We were visiting Japan. We were taking a vacation there. And he did not like the heated toilet seats. And I said to him, what's wrong with you? I mean, how can you not like a seat that's not freezing cold when you're sitting on it in the middle of the night?
Right.
I think it's because if you're in America and there's a heated toilet seat, that usually just means somebody was just sitting on it, which is always the worst feeling. I imagine that's like, it's like a instinctive revulsion.
I think you're right, actually, but I still don't understand how we can't separate the two.
Yeah, you just have to mentally, you know.
Yeah, I bet once you got used to it, it would be fine. But I know, like, if I sat down on a toilet in America, it was warm, I would be like, oh, no.
That's fair. I also wonder if maybe it's also because of the gender difference, just because I'm so used to sitting on toilets often that you just kind of accept whatever it is that you're getting, because if you have to go, you have to go. And I guess maybe for you guys, you literally, like, just aren't on a toilet seat as often as we are.
Yeah, that might be part of it. I mean, I definitely, like, I've looked into... So, like, Amazon sells all sorts of bidets, and there's, like, the really cheap ones that are just a hand, and then there's the ones that are, like, a full toilet seat replacement with, like, the warming seat and all that stuff. And I've definitely looked into getting one for my place, because I think it would be great. But I think that it would be really different, like, sitting in my place and being like, I use this toilet, as opposed to, like, a heated toilet seat in a public space where I would be like...
This is my toilet. I guess
that's true, but we were in a hotel room. We were sharing a hotel room, so it's not like we were out in public. I mean, in Japan, obviously, using a public toilet is not a terrifying experience because everyone's so clean. I definitely see your point about if you were in the States and you had to use one of these kind of bidet-style toilets right after somebody else, it'd be a little weird. So
yeah, I get it. Our toilets are terrible, I think, is the summary of this. Like, man, I'm always, even like going to Europe, which, like, Europe doesn't do bidets really in public spaces, but they at least do the, like, floor to ceiling doors, where you're, like, basically going into a tiny room to use the bathroom. I'm always so jealous of that because I'm so used to the US where it's like, somebody's just, like, looking under the door here.
With kids, like, in the women's bathroom, that happens a lot. We have this, like, I don't know, 3 to 4 year old crawling around. They, like, stick their head under. They're like, hello. And you're like, hey, so I know you don't know this is not okay, but it's not okay.
Yeah, it's the worst. And I just can't believe that that's... I mean, I know the whole reason back to, like, war on drugs level stuff. But, like... Oh, I can't stand it. I cannot stand every time I come back from Europe, I'm always like, how can we still be doing it this way?
Easier to clean, I guess.
It's easier to clean, and then it's also like because you can get into them from outside. If somebody this is what I've heard. The rumor was always like, if somebody passed out in a toilet in America, if they were shooting up in a toilet in America, you could still get in there to unlock the door from the outside. Whereas, like, those ones in Europe, you, like, can't get into very easily. I don't know how true that is. That's always just the rumor I heard about why America has those weak half-sized toilet doors.
Yeah, that's funny.
But yeah, it is. It's terrible, and we should all take a page from Europe's book in that regard. Also, like, towel warmers. I always miss towel warmers when I come back to the U.S.
Oh yeah.
And I really like the, like, Scandinavian style, where it's just like a wet room, so your shower is just, like, cordoned off as, like, part of the corner of your bathroom. So then when you need to, like, clean your bathroom, you can just use the shower to clean everything, and everything just goes down a drain in the middle of the room. I'm always very jealous of those. As somebody who has, like, for the last 7 years lived in apartments that have very bad old clawfoot tubs from, like, early Victorian era San Francisco, I would kill for a modern shower.
I've actually seen those in Hong Kong before. Like, just a shower pan and then everything all in once together, and you just that you just use a hand shower and just clean the whole bathroom.
It's great. It's a much better system.
Oh, Peter Jansen wants to know what a bidet is, and somebody jokingly said that it's a drinking fountain. It is not a drinking fountain. It is a little bit of a water fountain, but you use it to clean yourself.
He's got to be joking.
I don't know. I actually didn't really know what a bidet was for the longest time because we didn't have them in the U.S. and I hadn't yet gone to Asia. And honestly, I'm still not convinced I like them just because it just seems a little messy. But I just like the warming. I just like Japanese toilets for the warming stuff. The fact that you can like press buttons and it makes sounds. I just find it very satisfying how they've married like technology with the basic human function.
The most basic of functions, pooping. Pooping and eating, that's all we need to do.
I really like that I used the term shooting up and then somebody made a guns joke. I don't think they understood what I meant.
Or maybe they did.
they said everything goes back to guns in the U.S.
Well, I mean, that's true, but that's not what you were talking about.
I guess maybe we should clarify, because we do have a lot of wonderful international people tuning in where English is not their first language, so maybe we should actually clarify what that means.
Yeah, somebody clarified for them. That's a drugs term. That's like
yeah.
A,
so when
it
you,
goes
when
back
you,
to the heroin.
Yeah. You basically insert a needle. Hypothermic needle in your arm, and when you press the plunger, that's considered shooting up. Like you are shooting the liquid up into your bloodstream.
Quote unquote shooting it up.
But yeah, that not guns. So that is not why we have half size bathroom doors, I don't think.
To make sure nobody has a loaded AK in the toilet with them. Oh, that's funny.
I have to admit, my favorite part about these streams are when we start veering off into these random things.
Yeah, it gets a little different.
Yeah, the whole chat now talking about toilets, so.
Well, usually we talk about food, so. I guess that's just a different...
Yeah, we can't talk about that in quarantine, so...
Or, you know, if we talk about food, we have to follow it up with talking about other bodily functions, so it makes sense.
Adam says, have to.
I mean, we have to. It's yeah, it's in legal paperwork. Or legal documentation.
Adam, Specky Pup says, hope that you're having a great time playing today.
I am, except for I'm dying a lot. And makes me feel
you're
I
using
suck.
That Steam controller, so that's your problem.
There you go.
Oh gosh. Okay, I shouldn't say this one out loud, but I really want to, so I'm gonna do it.
Do it.
Elvis Knott says, "There's a hole in Daddy's arm where all his money goes." Reference to the drug stuff.
Oh, yikes.
Oh my.
That's dark. That is dark. That's a Friday for you.
Looks like it's a song, Dan Stone.
Oh, it's a song. Okay. We'll take that. Wait, I missed that over there. What is that? Oh, man. Do I go back for it? Yeah, probably.
I'm actually going to jump off because, I have a certain game to go play.
Animal Crossing, yeah, we got it.
Yeah, Animal Crossing. It's funny because somebody in chat would not let it go, asking whether we have a copy of this game, even after I deflected four times. I'm gonna go play. So have fun, Adam.
Hey, thank you, sir. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, good luck with the Steam controller.
Hey, thank you. It's a trip.
I am gonna try not to get motion sick here. So it's tough. It's a tough challenge.
All
but
right. Go say hi to Tom Nook for me.
Yeah, you know, he's stealing all my bells.
As you do. All right, thanks, Hayden.
All right,
yep.
Later,
have
Hayden.
A good one.
See
Bye,
ya.
Guys.
Well, fear not. We still have Elena and Willis to keep me company as I die. So, Elena, do you have any interest in playing this game?
So here's the thing. I like shooters fine, but for some reason I'm not really into the gorier ones. So this is like on the border for me. I haven't decided yet if I want to do it.
Okay. Yeah. Did you play 2016?
Mm-mm. Man, okay. My backlog is ridiculous. It's beyond not funny. It's just like pure sadness and darkness now.
Well, have you beat Ori yet?
No, because I got sidetracked. So some of my friends are asking to like set up gaming parties and stuff like that, just to kind of, you know, break the tedium of being at home.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of my friends are on PlayStation 4, like the savages they are. I'm just throwing a little shade because I prefer to play on Xbox, and I don't. So here's the thing. Gordon gives me crap all the time for the fact that, you know, on console you have to pay in order to be able to do multiplayer with, you know, your friends. And I already do that for Xbox because I did the whole upgrade to Game Pass Ultimate trick kind of thing with Xbox Live. And so I feel like I'm definitely getting my money's worth for that. But my friends are on PlayStation 4 and they want to play, which means I have to sign up for PlayStation, was it Plus?
Yeah.
And I don't really want to shell out for that. So I'm a little grouchy. My third shade right now, but yeah, I've been trying to set up for that, and I've been adding people on there. So I got a little sidetracked because so you know that game we were talking about where I played 70 hours, I'm probably almost close to 80 hours now.
Oh,
but
yes,
even though I didn't really say that I liked it. So yeah, I'm finishing up Frozen Wild for Horizon Zero Dawn right now, and then I'll go back to Ori.
That's funny. Oh, sweet. Okay. Now I can go back.
How many backlog games do you have, Adam?
Oh my god. Way too many. I own way too many games. But, I mean, at a certain point, like, I have a favorites list on Steam, and at a certain point, like, I'll go through and be like, you know what? Am I gonna go back to this? Am I gonna go back to this, really? Okay. Forget about it. I'm gonna take it off.
How do you keep track? Do you put like a priority list, or are you just like, I'll just randomly pick one today?
I try to stick with at least one or two games at a time, so I'm not like like dividing up my time. Just like, so yeah, I usually stick with something for a little bit, and then one of the hardest lessons for me as I got older was that, like, I don't need to finish a game. If I've gotten my enjoyment out of it, I don't need to finish it just to finish it, you know? Like, I think I'm gonna, like, Divinity Original Sin 2 is one of the games that I'm playing, and it's like, I've heard how long that game is. I'll probably get, you know, my enjoyment out of it without beating it, and be like, okay, that's cool. I mean, this game, you know, it's, what, 12 hours long? I can beat that. That's not a big deal, but other games that are, like, RPGs. Because I love RPGs, but, like, what was that? Xenoblade Chronicles 2.
Yeah.
I got a good chunk into that, and then I just fell off. And old me would be, like, pissed about it and go back. Older me is just like, you know, I fell off it for a reason, and I'm fine with that.
You cannot kill the priest.
I usually try to be realistic and just, you know, go to other things that I'm like, you know, I feel like doing this, or I feel like going this way.
Yeah, I mean, you know, so little time, you know, you just got work, got, you know, families, and then, you know, then you got games, priorities, you know?
It's true. Yeah.
If you
I still need to finish on PC, since I started PC gaming again recently, some of the backlogs I have include Sleeping Dogs, which I got for $3 only. It was on sale. And then there's the South Park bundle games as well.
Oh yeah,
that I got. So still need to finish those as well.
The Stick of Truth and the Fractured Butthole.
Fractured Butthole.
Yeah. Yeah, I've heard good things about Stick of Truth, so I'm waiting until it's on a really good sale. I'll probably pick it up and then play some of it and be like, okay, cool, I tried it. One of those games I'm you know, I'm okay being like, eh, I'm not gonna beat that. But I do like to own games in a digital collection just because it's so easy and there's just so many damn sales, you know.
Right.
It's just so easy to be like, all right, cool, I'm glad I own it.
All right, I'm just gonna break in real quick.
Please,
here. Spiky Pup. I thank you, I am well. I guess Spiky Pup came in a little bit later. Adam, he wants to know if you're playing from inside a box. And I just have to say, if you're up for it, Spiky Pup, you should scroll back up because there's been a great conversation about Adam being potential on the toilet while he's playing. We've had a lot of toilet in the day. Yeah. A lot.
I should try toilet gaming. I guess I'm missing something. I guess that's what a lot of people do, huh?
Well, I imagine a lot of people would play mobile games while they're on the toilet these days.
You would imagine, or you do? I mean, come on. You can be honest here. We're all friends. does anyone have any plans other than just surviving this weekend?
Sorry, I had to readjust my headphones because they are running out of battery. Can you repeat that one more time?
Yeah. Plans for the weekend, other than surviving.
Me or just the chat?
Anybody.
Everybody.
I am going to be busy continuing my rearranging of my living space here because it is not set up for you know, doing these kinds of streams. So hopefully next week I will be actually able to join you on video, finally.
Well, why don't you just stream from your toilet like I'm doing?
That would be even worse in terms of having to rearrange things. So let's not make this. Let's not put this on hard mode for me.
Nice. Yeah, I also need to clean up the living space a little bit to do some product shoots as well. Just to clean up, tidy up a little bit.
Oh crap, I can't remember if I came in this way. Oh yeah. Oh, wait, what was down there?
And then, for the most part, just catching up on some games, either on PC or on my Switch.
Switch.
I still need to finish Breath of the Wild.
How many hours are you in?
Maybe less than 10. I only finished.
Oh my goodness! I know. So much of that game ahead of you.
I know. I only finished. I only defeated one of the guardians. So there's like three more to go, or something like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Whew.
And then a bunch of other stuff.
That's a long game. It's like easily a 100-hour game.
Yeah, I got distracted with other games. I'm trying to finish this Super Robot Wars RPG right now. So, well, I'm almost done with that. I'm at the last two chapters of that game. I'll hop back on Breath of the Wild after.
Well, and then you got to find out when that soccer game comes out. I know you're excited about that.
Oh yeah.
Soccer game? Did I miss something?
Yeah, you did.
Adam and I talked about it before. It's called Captain Tsubasa. It's Rise of the New Champions. That's coming out on Switch and PC and PS4.
Yeah. Yeah. It's an anime soccer game.
Anime soccer game. That anime, or it came out as a Japanese manga and then expanded into various animes over the years, and then they finally released a new game that's finally out on console, and which hasn't been for a good 10 years. So everyone's I'm reading on forums that everyone's really stoked about this game.
Yeah, I that's a rabbit hole I never went down in terms of playing all the anime games. Mm. But I feel like once you go down there, it's hard to come back from it.
Yeah, I guess I didn't ask, are you into it because of the anime or because of the soccer?
I got into it because of the anime.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. I mean, I also like soccer in general, so this was like the perfect combo, and I was like, oh, this is pretty neat. And once the anime got to a level where the main character and the teams are in the Japanese leagues, like that, those get intense. Like the moves that they try to bust out, like, woo, you would not believe it.
All right, I got some more questions from the chat for y'all.
Yeah,
go for it.
All right, so I like this one a lot. Brian Finkel would like to know the oldest computer any of you have running still.
Oh.
Yeah, he says he
sure
has a 9-year-old PC that's still in great working order. I actually have one of my first builds still up and running. It is a 2007 build. So what is that? 13 years old almost. It still runs okay. I think I need to change it over to doing a Linux machine instead of a Windows machine just to get, you know, the last bit of life out of it. But some of my older relatives are using it, and I think it's time to upgrade them. So I'll give them something a little bit newer, but still used from my collection. I'll take that one back and put some Linux on it, and finally maybe get up to speed on Linux. I know everybody in chat who keeps saying, why don't you just, you know, install Linux? Will be very happy to hear me say this. So if you have a suggestion for a particular distro I should be using, let me know. What about you guys?
No, I don't
you don't
have
do
too much. Yeah. I usually try to get rid of most things anyway, so yeah, no, I oldest computer I have here probably is that Lenovo P1 from
this
last
is a better
year.
Question for Gordon, really.
I mean, yeah. I know he's got an old Xeon machine at home that he uses as his daily PC. Yeah, that thing's probably pretty old. Actually,
I don't,
you know,
think it's 12 years old, though.
Yeah, no, no. Well, I mean, he's got... I'm sure he has something old.
Yeah. And Willis, you're same as Adam?
Yep, pretty
much.
Out
with the old as soon as possible, in with the new as soon as possible?
Yeah, just the safe space.
Oh, yeah. Man, San Francisco living. It's hard.
Yeah.
Yeah, I've always been that way. Just fits in well.
Let's see. Oh, another question, more serious one.
Uh-oh.
Spiky Pop wants to know, Adam, how excited are you and I for Navi 2 x RDNA 2? I'm excited at the price performance proposition if we can count on AMD to stay true to being the value proposition. What do you think?
You can go for it, Elena. What do you think? Are you excited?
I like how you're like, give that right back to you.
I mean, I have some opinions, but yeah, I don't think people want to hear them.
I mean, honestly, I'm excited to see what comes down the pipeline. I think I'm still a little, to be honest, I still have a little trepidation just because it's just so often on the GPU side still that NVIDIA comes along and just kind of, you know, moves the football, so to speak, if we're doing a Charlie Brown reference, right? Like, you know, it just takes the joy out of it, and it's not even funny anymore. Not even enjoyable. So I think you'll see something good. I just don't want to get my hopes up too high, because what happens is that, you know, with everything floating around in the background, it can kind of take the joy out of it. But I think we'll see good stuff. That's my take on it.
Yeah, I'd say, you know, somebody had pointed this out a while ago that... can't remember what it was we were talking about, maybe during a full nerd or something, but somebody was like, oh, Adam never talks about AMD GPUs, he always talks about only NVIDIA GPUs. And it's true, I actually have no experience with an AMD GPU. I've always preferred NVIDIA. I mean, especially for the NVENC stuff. So, you know, on my end, like, I mean, I'd be willing to try it out for sure. I just, you know, yeah, I've always been willing to shell out the little extra dollar for an NVIDIA GPU. So, I it's not like I have like a strong, like, you know, affinity towards NVIDIA necessarily, but it, like there's reasons why I would lean that way. Same thing which was like there's always been reasons why I've leaned Intel on the CPU side rather than AMD. So, you know, that's just usually where my my head is at. So, I mean, I hope they bring, you know, good competition. It seems like people always, you know, want them to on the GPU side, so. But me personally, yeah, I don't know.
I'm just going to pop back to chat. I'm getting some Linux recommendations, and somebody basically said something like, try this one if you want, like, an intense Linux experience. I'm not actually sure what that means, and I'm not sure if I want an intense Linux experience.
Oh, you want to get intense with Linux. Like,
I don't know if I do. That does not sound like the way to win my heart over when it comes to Linux. It's like saying, do you want the episode Star Wars Episode 1 beginning point for this entire franchise, or would you like to start with Episode 4 like most people should?
I do remember that security friend I told you guys about offline. He had me run a security focused Linux distro on like a netbook one time, and like showed me like some like hacking tools. I can't remember the name of it, but that was kind of my my only experience with Linux. Locate the betrayer. Why can't I? Huh, weird. Oh, crap, I think I'm missing something here. Uh-oh. Man, I hate when I get stuck. Weird. Uh-oh. Uh-oh, my first major sticking point.
What's happened? You know, I just realized I've been neglecting Twitch chat. I'm so sorry, everybody. Let me take a pop over here.
How could you?
I know. Oh, hey, Mr. MacMac 1000. Yeah, sorry about that. They're wondering, Adam, how much did you pay for this game, and what platforms is it on? Do you know?
I mean, it's on all the major, or I should say the PC, PS4, Xbox, PC. It's not on Switch. I got the PC version. I got the $90 pre-order version that comes with Doom 64 and some other, you know, year one stuff. Because, I totally ate up Doom 2016, so I was like, I'm probably going to use all this stuff for this. Man, I do not know how to get through this wall. I feel like...
Also, sorry. Go ahead. I was just going to say to Twitch chat again, Tunaland gave me a sad face, and I just wanted to say I am sorry. I really am.
Oh, about intense Linux?
No, about ignoring them.
Oh.
By accident. The window got covered up a little bit, and I haven't been seeing the chat room moving, or the messages coming in.
Why do you hate them?
I don't. So yes, VC Jester on YouTube. Yes, it's true. We are on Twitch. We are streaming simultaneously as we normally do. So full nerd episodes, game streams, we usually go to both Twitch and YouTube. And usually Twitch has less of a delay between what we actually are seeing in real time and what pops up on the screen.
Yeah, and I signed up for this service called Restream that lets us throw out one stream, and then it just gets propagated up in the cloud. So far the quality seems pretty good, but I did, they have a long list of services that they support, and I saw Mixer on that list, and I was like, man, should PC World get on the Mixer bandwagon? What do you think, Elena? Sounds like she's...
Sorry, I muted because I needed to shift my headset around again. I mean, I don't actually tune into Mixer, but I think it's strong enough that it's not something that deserves to be made fun of. I just don't know how big it is relative to Twitch and YouTube that, I don't know. I mean, if you think you can output to it, I don't see why not. We can have more people coming in telling us how we're wrong about everything when it comes to consoles.
I mean, that is, I don't know if people even would show up. Man, I'm stuck. I do not know what to do. I guess I haven't been paying attention what my powers are or something. Like, I feel like I'm missing something here. Oh. Oh my god. Jesus Christ. Okay. Duh. I figured it out. I thought I... Anyway. Yep. I always hate that thing where you just like, you're like, man, I'm stuck, and then it's like, oh, okay, well, that was obvious. Yeah, it's interesting that Hayden said a lot of the stories in these codex things that you have to read. Like, I'm less like, I love this. I don't know. I love Doom 2016, and though it was bogged down by some cutscenes, I'm actually sad that they don't have more like cutscenes in this. I don't really feel like stopping and playing, or stopping and reading codex entries. Huh. Okay.
So there's a plot line for this to follow, right? Like, there's just not enough cutscenes.
Oh yeah, there's. Started. I mean, there's definitely, you know, a story here, and Hayden says it. It's interesting, but yeah, it's. Where the original one, you know, actually had cutscenes, it seems like this one, like, most of the story... I mean, we've seen a couple cutscenes, but it seems like most of the story is revolving around... most of the story is revolving around these codex entries. Shooting a sticky bomb or frag grenade in his mouth. Willis, you only have a PS4, right?
That I do, yes.
How come you didn't want a Pro?
Because I don't have a 4K TV. I have a really, I have a, I think it's Insignia, like 1080 TV at 60 hertz, and it was just, you know, I had that for a really long time, and then I just felt like, oh, when they came out with the PS4 Pro, I'm like, are they sure they're not gonna come out with a PS5 anytime soon? And sure enough, because how old is the Pro? It's only like three years.
I mean, only 3 years. That's still a while.
And I was like, I didn't need to, because I didn't need to upgrade a TV, so it didn't feel like a necessity to upgrade to a Pro, because, you know, it wouldn't really, it kind of defeats the purpose, right?
Yeah, but I also should say, Willis, you should upgrade your TV, man. 1080p?
I know.
No, yeah. HDR?
Oh, no, man. HDR, it's really old. It's, since 2000, when did I move to the Sunset area in San Francisco? 2012, so it's been a long time.
I had no idea about this.
But you've been enough, like, we just haven't, like, you know, like, hung out and turned off the TV, but yeah, it's a bad one.
That hurts my heart. your next upgrade is gonna be pretty damn killer, because you can get an awesome TV for not a ton of money now.
Exactly. So it'll be a good time to switch. Especially, I think it'll happen this year, at least with Black Friday for sure, when I look into all the deals.
The one I upgraded to last year, which, and then Dan did too, like, we all kind of jumped on that train, was TCL. Pretty good. Pretty good bang for your buck.
I love this. I believe it's Elvis Knott mentioned that they found their gateway PC from 2001, and it was like 17.
Wow.
Yeah. 1750. Wow.
Yeah, my very first Windows, like modern Windows PC, Pentium PC, cost like $2,500, I think.
Wow.
Ooh. Whoa.
Yeah, it was not. It was definitely the family machine.
I remember my ex-wife and I at the time got a cheap, was it Gateway that had the cow logo or whatever. I think it was Gateway. Yeah, that was like my first laptop. My parents had a computer, but yeah, that was like my first computer that I had. And then I had E-Machines. We've talked about that.
Oh, E-Machines.
Yeah, boy.
I remember E-Machines.
Man, that's a company name I haven't heard in a while.
E-Machines?
E-Machines.
Yeah. Oh, man, that's bringing me back. I have a question for all of y'all. Mr. MacMac 1000 on Twitch wants to know, what is each of our favorite mouse, keyboard, and controller? No, Tuna Land, I didn't ignore you again. I'm working on it. When I find that I've made a mistake, I do try to rectify it.
Yeah, go for it, Elena. You first.
Yeah.
So my favorite mouse and keyboard is not gaming related. I think we talked about this on, was it yesterday's stream? Not yesterday's, Wednesday's stream. That I because of my tendonitis, I have to use ergonomic equipment. So I have a roller mouse and I have a Gold Touch keyboard. And I really wish I could get a version of a Gold Touch keyboard with actual Cherry keys. Mine is kind of like probably mecha membrane or some kind of weird hybrid, because they feel kind of mushy like membranes, but they're really loud, like really loud. And then my favorite controller is actually still the Xbox 360 controller. I like the way it feels in my hand. I use Xbox One controller more just because I'm playing on Xbox One. And then at work, we don't have really any Xbox 360 controllers. So if I'm using a controller at work to play games, then I'm still using an Xbox One controller. But it feels a little more rectangular, a little harder in the angles in my palms when I'm holding it. And I prefer the more roundedness of the Xbox 360. But the Xbox 360 has a garbage D-pad. So thankfully, I'm not playing fighting games on that. Adam, how about you?
I have the Razer Huntsman Elite, I think is what the code name was. It worked, and I really like that that keyboard. Mouse-wise, I'm a big trackball fan. In terms of like a more standard mouse, I usually tend to like Razer mice as well. I like the, what is it, Naga Trinity, I think. It's kind of a short and wide, but it has like the detachable buttons or side panel or whatever for the different button options. And then controller, Xbox Elite Series 2, like I can't, it's hard not to play that one. If I weren't playing that one though, I really do like the 8-bit do SN30 Pro, not the Plus, the actual just the smaller SN30 Pro. I like how small it is, but how functional it is. It feels... The Super Nintendo controller is like one of my favorite controllers of all time, so It's cool to have a Super Nintendo controller that has updated functionality. I think that's all of them. Ah, crap. Man.
And Willis, how about you?
I don't have a favorite mouse and keyboard per se, just because, you know, especially if we're talking about PC gaming, I don't use mouse and keyboard a lot, and Adam knows this, I've only been using a laptop. I've been using the Concept D7 for the Acer Concept D7 for light gaming, and so I've just been using that on a first I started to use a PS4 controller, and then Adam lent me the Xbox One controller recently, so I've been using that to do some PC gaming. So it's been pretty good. Actually, if we were to do a debate about PS4 controllers and Xbox One controller, I'm kind of leaning towards the Xbox One, actually.
Oh, wow.
It's pretty good, yeah. And it feels a lot better, and then I like the position of the analog stick a lot more. It's just the way it positions. Like, I don't have to, you know, stretch my thumb out too far to play. But yeah.
All I want to say is that, Willis, I think you should consider yourself fortunate that you have a boss who actively encouraged you to get a work computer that let you game on it.
I know. That's what I say.
You know, it's one of those...
The best boss.
It's one of those computers you get to do amazing work on, but it ends up being... Well, I mean, video production in general. Usually there's a good crossover between video production and PCs and gaming PCs, so we're lucky.
Yeah. Otherwise, I would have been stuck with the HP Spectre X360 for both editing and gaming.
Yeah.
Which does not bode well with, handling the capacity of games doesn't do well.
Pretty much can't.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm surprised you edit on that thing, man.
It still works. I just do everything in, like, you know, half or a quarter mode quality.
But your renders, man. You can go take a nap.
Render takes a while.
Ooh, speaking of accessories or controllers and input devices, CC on YouTube said that their fingers are long and they still miss the Duke controller.
The Duke.
Yeah, I actually never really played on the original Xbox because I could not stand the size of that controller. I have smaller hands and it's not comfortable, and I get it that after years and years and years of consoles that were designed for like child size hands, it was nice just to say, like, I am a 6'4" man who actually can feel comfortable playing with this controller in my hands. I get it, but it kind of sucked for the rest of us until they brought over the Japanese the slightly smaller regular sized controller, and by then it was too late. I had no interest. I was not going to go back.
Well, and still that was probably even a little larger for you, right?
Yeah, I've tried it in my hands. It still doesn't feel particularly comfortable.
Yeah.
But it was at least not egregiously like the wrong size.
Yeah, the S was still pretty damn big considering. Hey, at least they tried something different. I mean, come on, it's not the dumpster fire that was the Nintendo 64 controller. I mean, come on.
Okay, that you cannot say that, Adam. That is an unfair thing to say when you like the Dream. What was up with that controller?
Wait. Which one's bigger, the Duke or the Nintendo 64 controller?
No, the Nintendo 64 controller, actually, you don't hold it the way
that
you do the
bigger?
Duke controller, so it's... I think the Duke is still bigger. No. It's like chunky, man. That one likes its food.
I think width-wise, like, the N64 controller is probably a little bigger, but like, you know, like Elena says, you don't hold it like a traditional controller. There's a bit of a learning curve with that, but, you know, it's definitely not like you would with the Duke controller.
I mean, and the Dreamcast, the only downfall of the Dreamcast controller, listen, well, there were some downfalls of the Dreamcast controller, but the major one was was the lack of shoulder buttons. They just only had the triggers. But, I mean, if you remember, the Dreamcast controller was the first one with actual, like, gun triggers like that. Like, you know, obviously the Xbox, you know, did it better. And I wouldn't call the Z trigger on the, you know, or Z, I guess it was called Z trigger, right? On the Nintendo 64, that wasn't really like a trigger per se. I still see that more of like an evolution of the shoulder bumper than an actual trigger. Anyway, got a VMU. See statistics. You could feed your little chow from Sonic Adventure. I mean, come on.
What about the GameCube controller?
I actually kind of like the GameCube controller.
Yeah.
I never really spent that much time on GameCube, so I don't feel like I can fairly say.
It was actually, honestly, a little small for me. Like, it was funny to see that come out, like, next to the Duke, because they were kind of, like, two completely different things. So, but yeah, I liked it. I think they were going in the right place. But once again, I mean, they, like, like the Dreamcast, it didn't have the full functionality, so you know, it didn't. It only had one shoulder button, right? Is that what it was? Yeah, and so like the, you know, like companies just had to work around it, and that's not a good place to be in. Wait, what?
So Adam, yes. We've been doing this for what? Almost 2 hours now.
Have we?
How are you liking the game?
I feel like I suck at it. And that's a little bit of a bummer, but
well, I mean, okay, in fairness though, you are trying to juggle us throwing a bunch of questions at you at the same time. So I feel like since we don't do this for a living.
No excuses, you know. No excuses.
Alright, fine. You freaking suck.
I know.
Ouch.
Yeah, tell me about it. And now I'm stuck again. Yeah, no, I mean, I'm a little bummed by the lack of, like, cutscenes. Like, I don't know, it's missing a little bit of the charm of 2016. But, I mean, the gameplay, yeah. It's hard, though. Man, it's hard. You gotta worry about these, Oh, okay, I see. Wait, what? Huh. I gotta go back. Also
you can't sling your way across.
Oh, you're right. Wait. Oh, I guess I jumped from that to that, huh? Okay. Yeah, you know, it's almost like the same with Ori, you know, where it's just like the first one, you know, has a feel to it. And it's definitely more of the same, but it's just like that first one. Damn. I beat the shit out of that first one. Also the first one kind of broke up like worlds like this. To like have some like indoor environments, like the space or the moon base or whatever you were on. So like I wish they were mixing it up a little bit more in terms of environments for like tight indoor spaces. But
well, Oh, Adam, question for you from chat.
Ooh. Sorry, fell.
Bad Dog on YouTube would like to know if you, or rather, do you also like just like the puzzles and extra abilities in this game? I preferred the more simplistic gameplay from Doom 2016.
Yeah. Yeah, they're trying to flesh it out a little bit more. The encounters, because the world is so big, and they're really trying to like spread things out. I don't know. Like I just like June 2016 was just like constant encounters. Like you're just constantly coming across people and just this is definitely a different pace to it. I probably still prefer the Doom 2016 at this point, but I mean this is still a damn good game. Super heavy. Yeah. Yeah, you know, and the I'll take a let me get to a spot that I can. Without being attacked. I do want to show off the Steam controller profile for those Steam controller lovers in there. If there are any out there. Let's see, I'm going to pause it and go into controller configuration. So browse configs. Oh, wow, that's funny. So yeah, I literally, when I loaded this up yesterday, there was only one of these. The one that I have is Doomslayer's Crucible configuration. That was the only one that had gotten brought in, but they had logged a ton of hours into it, so I feel like I don't know how they got so many hours. They had to have been a developer or something. Cause, I mean, the rest of them that are on here. Mostly default with gyro aim and dash, jump dash on bumpers. Easy access to each weapon. Designed to keep your thumbs on the stick as much as possible. Yeah, okay. I'll try this one, mostly default. Okay.
So you use the, What configuration did you use previously?
Yeah, when I loaded up the first one that was in there was the Doomslayer's Crucible configuration.
Oh.
The mat works properly, and I fine-tuned the trackpad to near perfection. Emulated rumble. The way that it's written out, like you can see how many hours like they've used this profile, and like I said, like the game just barely came out, so this had to either be somebody in QA testing or somebody on the developer who's like logged that many hours into it. Like that's crazy.
Right.
Which is cool. I'm glad they're out there doing that, but I do want to try this one only because yeah, I mean, I can go into any of these obviously and like, you know, do my own configuration on it. Like I do want to try gyro. Crap, I always forget which gyro is mapped to. Let's see. Like configuration. Oh, to mouse. Okay, gyro behavior, gyro button behavior, turns gyro. Okay, apply. Let's go mouse. Right touchpad, acceleration, haptics. Yeah. I don't want any haptics on the gyro. Okay. You gonna make sure, yep. Okay, so yeah, now with the gyro, if I move it around, oh, let me move back. You're not gonna be able to see this for a second, but you know, if I just move around the controller right now, it doesn't do anything. It's not until I hold down on the right thumb pad, then it becomes gyro, so then I can move it around and look. So the idea is, in conjunction with being able to swipe around on the thumb pad, you mm-hmm. if you hold it and then use the gyro motion, you can fine-tune your aiming. Ah, crap. I've always had problems with the gyro, though. I still never feel like I've gotten it to a place where I'm comfortable with it. There we go, nice. Because when I rest my hands on my lap like this, it's easy to move the gyro front and back, because like I'm kind of just laying it on my lap, but it's harder to do it side to side. So I feel like it kind of loses a little bit of its purpose. But there's some people that swear by the gyro, and that's how you get like the most accurate aiming feedback.
swear by the gyro.
They do, yeah. I know Hayden was brushing off the Steam controller. Oh, nice.
What he uses mostly, what, mouse and keyboard for?
Yeah, I
like
mean,
this, or?
You know, if there's something you'll learn about this community, is that mouse and keyboard is the holy grail that you're always going to be judged against, no matter what controller you use. But it's okay if you like controller. I do.
I think for me, I mean, I like controller, but I think the main reason for me to use controller is because my hands are not as dexterous, especially my left hand. Something I was, you know, kind of born with. So it was just one of those things where it's like, the keyboard. I always end up like hitting random keys as well, which kind of, you know, it messes up gameplays and whatnot. So I always feel like, you know, controllers are better for me just because of that.
Yeah, I mean, I grew up with them. I feel so comfortable with it. I know that a good mouse and keyboard player is the best player out there, but for me, I'm better with mouse and keyboard controller than I am with mouse and keyboard. So nice. Actually, and honestly, you should try the Steam controller when I'm done with my my challenge. I don't know how long I'm going to do this challenge, but after I'm done with it, you should try it, because it's actually a lot of people who enjoy it talk about the fact that, yeah, they have some mobility issues, and that it helps them kind of configure things so the way they like it and the way that it makes them feel comfortable. So I'd be curious to see what you think.
Yeah.
You can definitely fine-tune every aspect of this. I mean, if I were to... Let me pause it again. It'll be a little delay before you see it, obviously, but if I go in here, like, you know, I can change every single button associated in here. But then there's also the haptic feedback, the gyro right here that you can change, you know, the sensitivity, the rotation, acceleration, all that stuff. The right thumb pad here. Right now it's in the style of a mouse, but you actually have you can make a directional pad, a button pad, joystick, scroll wheel. I actually prefer trackball. They have trackball mode on right here, so you can turn trackball mode on. Yeah, you can change it, and that's not even like doing like changing action sets and action layers. Like, I haven't even gotten into that. It gets so deep. It's wild, the amount of configuration.
I'm going to jump in real quick and say I unfortunately have a hard stop at 5 p.m., so I am taking off.
Okay. What time is it?
It was good to hang out with you all. We will see you, or I will see you all next week on our streams. And yeah, have a good weekend, everybody.
Thank you, Elena.
Thanks, Elena.
Yeah, have a good weekend and
have a good weekend.
Stay safe out there or in there.
See you around.
Oh, Slayer Gate. Intense encounters. Oh, I do not have a Slayer key. What time is it? 5 o'clock?
It is 5 o'clock.
Hi, babe. Where's BB?
I know, BB has, she was on my lap a little bit when I was setting up, but, she's... Yeah. No, Willis is on. He was asking about BB. Oh, yeah. She said she's warm and cozy on the middle of our bed.
Oh, okay. I was going to say by the fireplace again.
No, it's not on right now.
Got
a Slayer key. Yeah, let me beat this level and then I think I'll call it as well.
Yeah.
The Slayer key thing looks like a little bit of a, oh yeah, the challenge room. I'm gonna start with the combat shotgun. Yeah, there we go. Oh yeah. So yeah, Doom 2016 had these challenge rooms where you like only have a certain amount of like tools on you, and they try to challenge you to beat, you know, like a big encounter of enemies. This is kind of like that, but I think doesn't seem like I have any restriction on what I can do. Yep, there they are. I will say I'm doing a ton of like right on the direction or the right directional pad, just like accidentally clicking in. Whoa! I got stuck somewhere. Almost dead. Ah. Nice. Oh, that guy was a beast. Ooh-wee. Oh no. Redo that. Oh no, retry if you are struggling. Okay, I can always come back. I will come back then. That's what I will do. Let's see where I'm supposed to go. I think back here. Oh.
Everyone in the chat is hungry, starting to talk about food now.
Oh yeah. Oh crap. Oh boy. I almost lost it there. Wait, where am I supposed to go? Oops. That's not what I wanted. Locate the betrayer. Oh.
Elvis Knott says they're having, trout with pistachio crust? Pistachio crusted trout.
Pistachio crusted trout? Wow.
Yeah.
That sounds pretty good. Lindsay likes the sound of that too. Oh yeah. Here we go.
And I am going to finish my Taiwanese, turkey braised rice.
Turkey braised rice?
Yeah, or braised turkey meat.
Oh,
rice.
Okay.
Yeah.
Got it.
Yeah, I made a huge pot last night, and I just need to cook a little bit more rice, and I'm good to go for tonight.
Nice.
Saving your people will not bring you peace. Only make the burden you carry.
This voice actor sounds familiar. I don't know if you're listening with volume, but you might be able to recognize him.
You seek to defy the Corn Maker herself. It is your people's time now to give penance. Just as it was mine.
Just as it were mine.
Hear me, Slayer. When his heart is laid to rest, then his soul will be at peace.
I'm going to look that up now.
He doesn't sound familiar to you?
No.
Yeah, I wonder if people in the chat maybe know who he is or recognize him.
Does anyone in the chat? What was that character's name again?
The Betrayer, I think.
The Betrayer.
At least that's what they referred to him at this point in the game. Maybe we find out it's you.
The Betrayer.
It is a Betrayer, yeah. Yeah, I can't say I'm a huge fan of this platforming.
The extraction point
the struggling days of jumping platform to platform.
Especially in first person. Not the best. Oh! Do you like seeing these? Ooh, yeah! Except for I hit the the right pad. Nice. I guess I'll go down there. Okay. Oh no! Oh, you recharge? Okay, I didn't realize your dash has to recharge.
Oh.
Oh man, wow. Oh, and if you use both, you have to wait for both to recharge. Weird.
Oh boy.
Let's see.
You got this, Adam. You got this.
Oh no! That didn't work. Oh. Oh crap. Oh man. That was lucky. Woo-wee. That was got me a little puckered up there.
Oh
Oh, what is this? Power-ups. Onslaught.
Spiky Pup just said the flaming spiky thing reminds me of Super Mario Castle level.
Oh, I know, right? Yeah.
I know. I was like, look familiar.
I was never good at platforming. Just not a Mario fan. Lindsay's really good at it. Not me.
Yeah?
Yeah. Yeah, you'll have to come over and play some Mario with Lindsay.
Oh, yeah. It'll be funny to watch Lindsay and Diana play Mario together.
Oh, why? Because she's really good?
No, Diana's quite the opposite.
Oh, no, I'm the opposite.
I teach her, you know, to hold the dash button and then like do a jump to do a quick, you know, like far, you know, dash jump, but she can't really do that, so she ends up falling most of the time. Pretty funny.
Oh crap. Oh, weird. Ran out of ammo.
Natalie Gray said, "This looks like Serious Sam meets God of War."
Yeah, I could see that. Serious Sam, man, that's a fast-paced game.
Never played that before.
Yeah, it was more PC centric. But yeah, it was like just meant to be like just like super fast paced. Oh crap.
Bad Dog is requesting Adam to play the Doom soundtrack on his guitar.
I do not, no. That would be pretty cool, though. I mean, I used to play a long time ago. I would, man, yeah, if I still played, I would totally learn this soundtrack.
Have you ever played Guitar Hero?
Oh, dude, Guitar... I brought the Xbox 360 in to the office. Mm-hmm. Guitar Hero 3... Oh, man, I love it. nice. Yeah, we're gonna hook that up. Luis is gonna hook it up. Yeah, we're gonna have some fun. I'm very excited about that.
Nice.
Huh. I don't know what to do with these rewards. Oh. Oh, that's cool.
Oh, Peter Jensen just tell you to ask Lindsay to play Cuphead or Mega Man on stream.
Oh, God. I don't know if I want to put her through that. That's...
Oh, man.
Cuphead.
No, that's like... you're asking for arguments there.
Yeah, I can't do it. I'm not good at all. Obviously, we talked about that. So there you go. That was. I'm gonna use my handy dandy little stream deck here. That was
nice.
That was Doom Eternal. Thank you.
Doom Eternal.
Thank you, everybody, for joining.
How do you feel?
I need a nap. That was.
You need.
Wow, that was intense. Need to get up and get out of this chair, walk around a little bit.
Oh yeah. 2 hours of gaming, stretch, definitely stretch. Rest your eyes.
Thank you, everybody, for showing up. Thank you, Willis and Elena, for moderating the chat.
And Hayden dropping
yeah,
in.
Yeah, Hayden dropping in, talking about his review. That was fun to get everybody involved. Hopefully everyone has a good weekend. We'll definitely be back next week with some fun streams. We've got the full nerd. We're going to do some Q&A stuff. We have some plans to continue this work from home staycation trip.
Oh yeah,
whatever you want to call it.
It's not going to stop us from streaming for sure.
Not at all. Not at all. Probably some more gaming. You know, here and there we'll see. I know Resident Evil 3 is coming out next week, so we'll definitely catch up on that. And then also Control. I need to reacquaint myself with Control because I love that game, but it's been a bit since I tried it. So anyway, yeah. Thanks, Willis. Have fun with your chicken braised rice.
Rice.
Thank you. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in. Have a good weekend. Yeah. We will see you later.
See you, everyone.